Chapter 2. "It's simple, really, Mr. Kennedy," Max said, moving to the cracked plaster wall and finding a patch that wasn't covered with graffiti. She pulled a thick stub of chalk out of her baggy sweater pocket and started sketching on the wall, turning it into her blackboard. "Please hear me out, sir. Try to see what I see." Max, who enjoyed drawing in a beat-up sketchbook she rescued from a dumpster, chalked in a lump of circles radiating stink marks. She labeled it manure/biofuel. "To stay warm this winter, all we have to do is arrange a meeting with Mr. Sammy Monk." "The owner of this building?" said Mr. Kennedy, skeptically. "The landlord who doesn't even know that we're here? That's Mr. Sammy Monk?" "Yes, sir," said Max, totally engrossed in the diagram she was drafting on the wall. "We need to convince him to let us have all of his horse manure." Mr. Kennedy stood up. "All of his horse manure? Now, why on earth would we want that, Max? It's manure." "Well, once we have access to the manure, I will design and engineer a green gas mill for the upstairs apartments." "A green what mill?" "Gas, sir. We can rig up an anaerobic digester that will turn the horse manure into biogas, which we can then combust to generate electricity and heat." "You want to burn horse manure gas?" "Exactly. Anaerobic digestion is a series of biological processes in which microorganisms break down biodegradable material, such as horse manure, in the absence of oxygen, which is what anaerobic means. That's the solution to our heating and power problems." "You sure you're just 12 years old?" "Yes, as far as I know." Mr. Kennedy gave Max a look that she unfortunately was used to seeing, the look that said she was crazy, nuts, off a rocker. But Max never let the look upset her. It was like Albert Einstein said, "Great spirits have always encountered violent opposition from mediocre minds." Not that Mr. Kennedy had a mediocre mind. Max just wasn't doing a good enough job explaining her bold new breakthrough idea. Sometimes the ideas came to her head so fast they came out of her mouth in a mumbled jumble. "All we need, Mr. Kennedy, is an airtight container, something between the size of an oil drum and a tanker truck." She sketched a boxy cube fenced in by a pin of steel post. "Heavy plastic would be best, of course, and it would be good if it had a cage of galvanized iron bars surrounding it. Then we just have to measure and cut three different pipes, one for feeding in the manure, one for the gas outlet, and one for displaced liquid fertilizer. We would insert these conduits into the tank through a universal seal, hook up the appropriate plumbing, and we'd be good to go." Mr. Kennedy stroked his stubbly chin and admired Max's detailed design of the device sketched on the flaking wall. "A brilliant idea, Max," he said, "like always." Max allowed herself a small, proud smile. "Thank you, Mr. Kennedy." "Slight problem." "What's that, sir?" "Well, that container there, the cube, that's what, 10 feet by 10 feet? "About. And you say you need a cage of bars around it? You also mentioned three pipes and plumbing. Then I figure you're going to need a furnace to burn the horse manure gas, turn it into heat." Max nodded. "And a generator to spin our own electricity." "Right. Won't that cost a whole lot of money?" Max lowered her chalk. "I suppose so. And have you ever noticed the one thing that most people squatting in this building don't have?" Max pursed her lips. "Money?" "Uh-huh. Exactly." Max tucked the stubbly chalk back into her sweater pocket and dusted off her pale, cold hands. "Point taken, Mr. Kennedy. As usual, I need to be more practical. I'll get back to you with a better plan. I'll get back to you before winter comes." "Great. But Max?" "Yes, sir." Mr. Kennedy climbed back into his lumpy bed and he pulled up the blanket. "Just don't get back to me before 7 o'clock, okay?" And here's a look at Max's plan.